Hello and welcome. You're watching Commodities First right here on ET Now. I'm Ajay Sharma. Let's take a look at the headlines right now. The Indian rupee has a weak session of trade. Disappointing macro cue as well as the strengthening dollar index continue to weigh on the currency. Most other Asian currencies have also had a dull session of trade. The rupee finally ended the day at 66.77 to the dollar. The rally for gold also continues. Investors turn to the bullion amidst weakness in global equities. Gold prices are currently trading above $1,270 an ounce mark. However, the strong dollar has been capping gains for the bullion today. Volatility persists for the oil market. Fresh comments from Russia's energy minister suggesting global oil surplus will persist till first half of 2017 also is weighing on prices. Both Brent and the NYMEX are trading lower by almost 1%. But let's talk about the currency space. That's where most of the volatility is. Rupee is also kind of slipping towards the 67 mark. Look at how 66.76 is the market actually ended. Of course, there has been a lot of volatility in other global currencies. Yen is back at its ways. In fact, yen has strengthened in the last couple of hours after commentary seemed to be indicating that Bank of Japan is again trying to calm the economy and the market, saying that they're still planning to extend the stimulus. So yen dollar pair will also come up on your screen. It went to 109 and then 108.8 is what it is currently trading at. Also pull up the dollar GBP, that is also in focus. In fact, the GBP has taken a knock ever since there has been commentary coming in from Bank of England indicating clearly highlighting the possibility of even recessionary trend coming in the region if Britain actually goes out. So Brexit fears are looming on the pound as well. That's gone down 1.44 versus the dollar right now. We have two special guests joining us on the show today. We have Craig Earlham, a senior analyst at Oanda, who's joining us from the phone line from London. And of course, we have Anish Chakravarti of Deloitte, who's right here with me in the studios. Gentlemen, good evening. Thanks a lot for your time. Craig, let me start with you. Again, there is a lot of volatility coming in as far as global currencies go. Let's talk about what's happening in your own region ever since commentary from Bank of England actually scared the markets. What are your observations on GBP?
Yes, there's been a lot of volatility in the pound since yesterday, I think. There was a lot of information to absorb from Mark Carney yesterday. He, of course, it highlighted the risks associated with a possible Brexit to the frustration of the Leave campaign. He highlighted the possible inflationary impact that this could have, as well as the impact on growth. And the important point about this is that doesn't necessarily give you an indication of how the BOE would respond to this, because, of course, the higher inflation would typically be associated with raising interest rates in order to maintain prices, but then lower growth would typically mean that the Bank of England would cut interest rates in order to support the economy. So I think by highlighting both of these, he's really left the door open to either response to a Brexit. And I think that's why we're seeing so much volatility in the pound. The initial response, of course, was that the pound rose above 145 against the dollar, and now today we are seeing it back around this 144. So I still do think there is this element of confusion in the UK right now about exactly how the Bank of England would respond should the UK vote to leave the European Union.
Craig, just a quick follow-up. In fact, minutes back, there's also commentary coming in from the IMF. Christine Lagarde seemed to have indicated that Brexit could send shockwaves through the UK economy. We are, of course, moving closer to the referendum, which is scheduled to happen in June. If it were to happen in terms of Brexit, if it actually happens in terms of the UK economy or Britain, how badly could it be hit in your view?
Well, I think the damage could be quite significant. We've already seen plenty of evidence in the last few months that companies are holding off on investment decisions, they're holding off on property investment, they're holding off on hiring investment because they don't know what the outlook for the UK economy is going to be, whether it's going to be a member of the European Union or not. So I think this quite indicative of how companies would respond after. I think the initial response would be a continued slowdown in the UK economy because, again, companies want to know what kind of relationship the UK would have with the European Union going forward. Beyond this, I think we could see companies actually moving business over to the European Union. Sure, they may retain some parts of the of the business in the UK. But I think they would be looking to maybe diversify their business and move parts of it to the European Union, which I think could have very damaging effects for the UK economy in the short to medium term. I guess what happens thereafter depends on what trade deals get put in place and where the UK then positions itself in the world. But again, this is a much longer term view. I think the immediate impact could be quite damaging.
Right. Anish, you look at the Indian economy very closely. Rupee, of course, is also, weakening a little bit as far as today's session is concerned. If one were to look at the pound INR pair, 96.20 is what it is trading at right now. But in case Britain actually moves out, what kind of number are we talking about here in this particular pair? And otherwise, overall, what are your thoughts? Because we are big trading partners with Britain and we do conduct a lot of business in GBP.
Right, and let's break this up into a few different notches. I think first let's start with the UK itself. I think over the past few years, we've seen that the British government has really gone out to woo business and business from this part of the world. We've had prime ministerial level visits about a few years back. There's a lot of connection with India that is on at this point of time. And, you know, UK has also done a few things. For example, the corporate tax rate has been lowered just again to woo business. The problem with Brexit that we see in about a month is, of course, what has already been stated, that there are recessionary pressures which are going to hit it. There's going to be perhaps a shock on the pound as well, to the extent maybe 10 to 20%. But overall, I think we must not forget that it is not just the UK who's going to suffer, but it's going to have an impact on the European Union as well. Because I think we should not leave the euro out of this equation. Typically, when you have such a situation, both sides will suffer. If I link it back to India at this point of time, I think the Indian currency, given the current status, and I'm going to link it to the dollar, has done relatively well. It is definitely depreciated against the dollar, but then we have seen other currencies also depreciate against the dollar, but not much higher than the extent to which the Indian rupee has depreciated. Therefore, the real rate of the rupee at this point is higher. Typically, and we've seen that has taken a mark on the exports, for example, where perhaps a little bit of depreciation would have helped the exports pick up. Vis-a-vis the pound, at this point, I think, again, I'll link it to the dollar. Perhaps it will help Indian exports into the UK, but overall, the pound depreciating perhaps doesn't bode well for the economy as such. Slightly better for India at this point of time, but then again, the European Union and UK together business suffering, because Germany also, let's not forget, is a very large trade partner of India. That is going to be, I'm going to have a, quite a big concern as far as Indian trade is concerned, purely on the currency perspective.
Right. Craig, let's shift focus and talk about the yen. It went to almost 105 and then back to 109. And now it's strengthened just a bit yet again after commentary indicating that BOJ is still open to loosen their purse strings. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think we need to put into perspective, first and foremost, the strength that we've seen in the yen over the past 2 weeks. This doesn't even equate to the size of the sell-off that we saw in the pair just a week before this. So at the moment, what we are effectively in is correction mode. We're only seeing a part retracement of that move 2 weeks ago. So I think we need to put these recent gains into perspective in the dollar again. The yen. Of course, there has been a number of comments from the finance ministry recently suggesting that there could be some form of currency intervention in the market if the yen does get unreasonably strong. There's been suggestions that we could see the Bank of Japan loosen monetary policy further, which could potentially have a depreciating impact on the yen. But at this moment in time, I am not convinced that the markets are buying into this. The markets have continued to sell the dollar yen. And despite the fact that we've had these warnings previously, despite the fact that we've had the anticipation that the Bank of Japan are going to loosen monetary policy further, and if we don't get any action from the Bank of Japan or the Finance Ministry in the next couple of weeks, I do think we could potentially see the dollar yen selling off again, and I wouldn't count out the possibility that we could be seeing the dollar yen back at around the 100-150 mark.
Right, Craig, a quick observation on what's happening in China. The currency there also, after trading stable to slight positive bias, has started slipping once again.
Sure, I mean, we have seen a lot of stability in the Chinese yuan for quite some time now. There does seem to have been an agreement back in February, March time at the G20 meeting where the central banks have almost committed to some form of stability. We've seen actions from the Federal Reserve, European Central Bank, Bank of Japan, which would all indicate this. And I think the Chinese Central Bank, the People's Bank of China, also seems somewhat committed to this. We've seen very little volatility in the Chinese yuan against the US dollar since then, and since the start of the year when it did create a lot of turmoil in the markets. I do think the People's Bank of China is going to be open to more monetary stimulus if we do see a further slowdown in the Chinese economy. But to be honest, the data that we've seen from China over the last month or two has been much more positive. It seems that this looser monetary policy from China, the weaker Chinese yuan on a trade-weighted basis, is benefiting the economy at this stage, and the fiscal stimulus as well is also aiding this stronger growth as well. So I think at this moment in time, I don't think there's necessarily a need for the People's Bank of China to be overly active in the market, and I think this period of relative stability is actually benefiting the global economy.
All right, Craig, we'll let you go on that one. Thanks so much for your time joining us in the discussion today. Anisha, let's just focus and talk about a couple of factors which have happened in the last few hours, particularly creating pressure on the rupee. Well, yesterday evening, the data seemed to be suggesting that the growth is slowing down once again, and inflation, especially the food part of it, is edging higher. How did you analyze the data? And it definitely bodes negative for the rupee in the medium term, isn't it?
Right. And, you know, last month when the CPI numbers were released, I think there was a lot of comfort that from certain quarters, I must say, that, you know, inflation is largely under control. But in a country like India, I firmly believe that when you have large unpredictable monsoons and the agricultural output is something which cannot be predicted, you're always going to have pressure on food. And typically, as we've seen, we've earlier seen pressure on pulses. This time we are seeing vegetables, fruits as well. And so typically the food inflation is part of our economy, it's part of our DNA, I believe, and it's going to remain. If you look at the food numbers, really jumped up. But then again, let's not forget there are some other areas also where inflation has had a marked impact. One is, of course, the rise of crude from what it went down, which bottomed out in January up to about a 44, 48 a barrel. And that is having a pressure as far as the fuel numbers are concerned. It is captured under miscellaneous items under CPI. So if you look at the core numbers, the core inflation itself is rising as well. And I think this is part of the package. It's going to continue for a while. And typically, we are not going to have certainty on at least the agricultural front till we know monsoons are going to be normal. There's a firm belief it will be, but we are not seeing that at this point of time. And only then will we know how the inflation trajectory will pan out for the rest of the year.
Right. Anisha, I'm glad you brought that point up, because if you look at the last 1 month graph of crude oil, the prices have rebounded very sharply. The other big basket of our import basket is gold. Gold prices have shot up, though the absolute volume number is low, but it continues to remain a large part of our import basket. Other commodities, rubber, industrial metals, all of them have rebound. Some people on the street are also scared that this is, you know, the kind of rebound we've seen in commodity prices and food inflation and slow growth. It may be putting a question mark, or the window of another rate cut in August may become questionable once again. What are your thoughts? Because that would again have pressure on the rupee.
I find it quite unlikely that we are going to see a rate cut in August. You know, we must remember that there are two aspects of monetary policy. One is, of course, the rates. The other is liquidity. And from the RBI, we are seeing a focus on liquidity. Let me come back to the commodities, because that's an interesting point you've raised. And I'll link that to the IIP as well. So if you're looking at the rubber production and plastics and so on and so forth, that falls largely under capital goods. And capital goods contracted by about 15%. We've had 5 straight months of contraction as far as capital goods is concerned. And you know, that is clearly a worry. And capital goods is one area which has been underperforming for a long time now. And that has an impact on exports as well. You know, March was a good month because our trade deficit really contracted to about $5 billion only. But then again, once trade deficit is contracting, it is not just exports which have contracted, it's also imports. And on the import side, you rightly mentioned gold. But gold contraction was about 80%, but then oil also, which is a large component of the basket, contracted about 35%. So, you know, this is, again, largely, if you look at the trajectory, purely because of global cues. It's not because of domestic conditions at this point of time. So is there an upside risk as far as all this is concerned, having a direct bearing on the rupee? Of course there is, in my mind. Mm-hmm. And again, a lot of this will depend on how the global cues, how the trajectory of crude, as we are seeing now rising, pans out. We've always seen in the past, crude remains high, inflation in India remains high. It's just we've had a windfall over the last 1 year, but maybe it's time it is reversing at this point of time. So rate cuts, in my mind, quite unlikely at the immediate effect.
Right. So taking all of that, this particular kind of environment into account, Tanish, very quickly, what kind of range would you outline for us as far as the rupee dollar pairs goes?
I think, again, as I've mentioned, I think the real rate is being held back. There is a chance that the rupee may depreciate further, and that is actually going to be a boon for export at this point of time. The export markets, purely on global cues, are extremely weak. We've seen engineering services and goods, which is really the highest, again, component of our export basket, been very weak. There is a push towards the Middle East we are seeing on that front, but that is also not picking up. I think there is a chance for the rupee to depreciate further, perhaps to the extent of about 60 to 100 basis points at least. But then again, in the next few months, we will see. I suspect that we will see the rupee go down further about in the next 30 to 45 days.
All right, Anish, we'll let you go on that one. Thanks so much for dropping by in our studios today.
My pleasure.
Let's take a short break on that note. On the other side of the break, we'll talk about gold. The prices are clearly rallying. You talk of Stanley Druckenmiller and other global fund managers, all of them are recommending some part of your portfolio should be gold. We'll discuss all of that when we return.